Welcome to Azure Essentials. If you're new to Azure as a solution for infrastructure as a service, or IaaS, in the next few minutes, we'll break down some of the essentials of what you need to know to plan and implement your solutions on Azure IaaS as a primer to your deeper learning. With cloud computing, the first question you might have is, what's the difference between IaaS and platform as a service, also known as PaaS? Well, the simplest way to distinguish between the two models is by taking a look at what's managed by us as a cloud vendor and what's managed by you. With PaaS, we run your compute and app services, and you manage your apps and data. Whereas with IaaS, we manage your compute, storage, and network infrastructure, and you manage everything else. Azure offers a robust set of services that comprehensively supports both PaaS and IaaS scenarios. Using IaaS services, Azure becomes the equivalent of your physical data center in the cloud. We operate over 40 regions globally, and that's growing. A region represents a collection of data centers, which allows us to respect your data sovereignty needs and provide you with a robust failover model. You can choose the regions where your infrastructure runs so that it's closest to your data and your customers. Access can be over the internet, or to optimize the connection to the service, you can establish a fast and dedicated connection to Azure via Express Route. In IaaS, compute, storage, and networking services resemble those you'll be familiar with in your data center. But there are some new concepts to help you create resilient and elastically scalable solutions. Let's start with compute. As an IT professional, you'll be familiar with deploying solutions to on-premises infrastructure using VMs. Anything you run in compute in a VM on-prem, whether on Windows or Linux, you can easily run in Azure, and you'll only pay for what you use. Azure also offers a large catalog of predefined first and third-party reference VM images in the Azure Marketplace that you can deploy. Additionally, you can define your own from within Azure or deploy images that you already have. During this specification phase, you can establish a resource group to contain your compute, storage, and networking configurations. Now, to accelerate this effort, you can choose from hundreds of predefined Azure Resource Manager templates available on GitHub that make it easy to configure a complex multi-tier application in a few clicks. You'll need to specify an Azure location to host your VM and the size of VM you require. Azure offers a range of VM sizes, differing in the power and performance they offer, but you can easily switch between VM sizes at any time. For example, while doing dev test, you may only need the entry-level A-series VM for your application. Then for a higher performance when in production, you may want to switch to a D-series VM or a series optimized to the needs of a specific workload. You can learn more about compute sizes at the link shown. Now, an important step in defining your compute is considering availability and redundancy. Here, availability sets are an important concept to become familiar with. Grouping two or more VMs together in an availability set will protect your workloads against downtime. Azure will automatically place VMs in the same availability set across different hardware to avoid any single point of failure. Alongside availability sets, Azure provides several other options such as Traffic Manager, VM scale sets, and availability zones to make your applications highly resilient, available, and scalable. Moving on to storage, Azure offers multiple storage types to support both new and existing business applications. For IaaS-based solutions, three storage types are important: blob, disk, and file storage. Now, you may only need to store small amounts of data, or you may need to store petabytes. Like compute, you pay only for what you use, and you can scale up and down based on your needs. Azure blobs provide highly scalable, unstructured storage, and you can use them to store just about anything, including text files and documents. Blobs can be made private or available for public access. Now, you can select from both hot and cool blob storage tiers. The hot tier provides high performance, low latency access, while the cool tier can offer significant cost savings when you don't require frequent access. If you do wish to attach data disks to your VMs, Azure offers conventional hard disk drive options, as well as solid state drives for your I/O intensive applications. The third type of storage available to support IaaS-based apps is Azure Files. This is like having a conventional file share in the cloud. You may need this if you're migrating apps onto Azure that require support for traditional SMB file storage. Now, as part of your disaster recovery plan, you can set up Azure Storage to synchronize stored data across two geographically separated regions, hundreds of miles apart. This means your data is durable even in the event of a complete regional outage or a disaster. In addition, you can use Azure Site Recovery to protect your entire environment. Azure Site Recovery automates the replication of your VMs to a secondary Azure region based on policies that you set. Now, this will not only replicate your entire Azure IaaS solution, but you can also use it to replicate your on-premises systems too. Now, when it comes to networking in Azure, the on-prem concepts you're familiar with will also apply in the cloud. When you deploy your VMs, you do so into a virtual network. This becomes your private network address space in which your machines can seamlessly communicate with one another. For security, you can segment this further, so you have separate subnets and you can use IP-based access control lists or ACLs within the subnets. Also, you can apply load balancing and other common networking concepts just as you would in your on-prem environments. For hybrid connectivity, you can connect the VMs in Azure to Active Directory and on-premises resources using the Azure Network Gateway. Moving on to management and security. Once deployed, you can monitor the health and availability of your IaaS services and applications through the Azure portal. Through Azure Monitor, you can easily create dashboards to surface only what you want to monitor. You can use Azure Log Analytics and Azure Application Insights to explore Azure log data and application performance data. Also, you can set up alerts around specific SLAs that you may be tracking. For granular access, role-based access control, or RBAC, allows you to set different job roles into resource groups. You can use these to define the level of access users have when administering Azure. Additionally, for proactive resource optimization, Azure Advisor analyzes your resources based on usage and provides personalized recommendations that can be reviewed and implemented easily. Now, in terms of security, one of the most important things you'll want to do is enable Azure Security Center. This provides a view of the security state of all of your Azure resources. At a glance, you can verify the appropriate security controls are in place and configured correctly, and quickly identify any resources that require attention. For example, production VMs that aren't using encryption. You can also set up alerts and receive recommendations. So that was a brief tour of the essential things to know about Azure IaaS as you start to plan and implement your IaaS solutions on Azure. This is a big topic, and we encourage you to continue your learning experience by checking out the additional learning experiences in the link shown.